In 1888, Austria-Hungary was determined to have the most modern infantry rifle in the world. This was the Infanterie Repetier-Gewehr Modell 88, better known as the Mannlicher 1888. This nearly forgotten rifle was fantastically modern when it was adopted. A small bore, magazine-fed, clip-loaded, straight-pull, bolt-action rifle. It caused a revolution in infantry tactics, arguably to the same extent as the French Model 1886 Lebel. To understand the context of the Mannlicher 88, we have to go back to at least the Austro-Prussian War of 1866, when the army of the old Austrian Empire was soundly defeated at Königgrätz by the Prussian army. The Prussians famously used a breech-loading rifle with a rate of fire much higher than the Austrian muzzleloaders. The defeat shook the old empire, and in 1867, a compromise created the dual monarchy of Austria-Hungary, a multi-ethnic, multilingual empire with two constituent kingdoms and three armies. Königgrätz also provided the motivation to replace the muzzle-loading Model 1854 Lorenz with the modern breech loader, the Werndl. In 1887, the Werndl was upgraded to use a bottlenecked 11mm black powder cartridge, which, for its day, had excellent ballistic performance. We also need to pause and consider just how important the infantryman's rifle was in the second half of the 19th century. This period marked the zenith of the infantry rifle's influence on the battlefield. The mass of ordinary soldiers with rifles generated most of the firepower, and it was the decisive arm. In coming decades, this was going to change. Artillery and machine guns would be the decisive weapons of the First World War, not the infantryman's rifle. But in the 1880s, the rifle still reigned supreme. True quick-firing artillery would not be introduced until after 1897 with the famous French 75, and the machine gun had just been invented and would not be adopted in large numbers until essentially the start of the First World War. So, in the early 1880s, when repeating rifles with the Kropatschek tube magazine appeared with clear advantages over single-shot rifles, clinging to the old single-shot designs invited another Königgrätz-like crushing defeat. The dual monarchy learned from the terrible lesson of 1866, and a radically new straight-pull bolt-action rifle designed by Ferdinand Mannlicher was adopted in 1886. It was the first clip-loaded rifle ever, and 50 years before John Garand, packet-loading was introduced. We know it today as the N-block clip. The clips for the Mannlicher 1886 held five of the old 11mm Werndl black powder cartridges. After the last round was chambered, the empty clip fell out of the magazine with a familiar ping. The Mannlicher 86 was stunningly modern, simple to use, accurate, and had a blistering rate of fire with a high muzzle velocity. Finally, the Austro-Hungarian Empire had achieved its goal of having the most modern infantry rifle in the world. Ah, crap! The story of the Model 1886 Lebel has been told many times, and by people with much better channels than mine. So here's the summarized version. The populist General Boulanger wanted a high-velocity, flat-trajectory rifle right now, so they stuck a Kropatschek tube magazine onto an old Gras rifle, necked it down to 8mm, and voila, this monstrosity was somehow the most modern rifle in the world. Fortunately, the imperial plumed hat makers of Vienna had nothing to fear, because Ferdinand Mannlicher wasted no time redesigning his clip-loaded rifle to use a new jacketed 8mm cartridge. This, at last, was the Mannlicher 88. There was only one problem. practical smokeless powder was still a French state secret, and so the Habsburgs initially had nothing else to use but dirty old black powder. Everything else about this rifle was fantastically modern, except the propellant. It was a living anachronism, a clip-loaded, magazine-fed, small-bore, black powder rifle. The new 8mm black powder cartridge has a muzzle velocity of 530 meters, or about 1738 feet per second, a rather modest improvement over the 490 meters per second of the old 11mm cartridge. If you're accustomed to smokeless powder velocities, 1700 feet per second might sound almost squib load weak to you, but for black powder, this is absolutely sizzling. And while I'm on the topic, I need to address the misconception that backwards old Austria-Hungary was late to the smokeless powder party. The Lebel is worshipped as the first smokeless powder rifle, but in fact, the Austrian Empire adopted smokeless powder gun cotton cartridges for their Lorenz rifle and for field artillery over 25 years earlier. They abandoned them in 1865, not because they didn't work, but because nobody could figure out effective safe handling procedures and the factories kept blowing up. So stick that in your Lebel and smoke it, pun intended. In 1889, a Major Schwab developed a smokeless powder that was chemically treated to eliminate unpleasant fumes that were encountered when firing on indoor ranges. The treatment produced a light smoke, and this has led to the powder being described as semi-smokeless. It was promptly adopted as the Gewehr Patrona Model 90, and it raised the velocity to 630 meters, or about 2,066 feet per second. This was essentially the same velocity as the French Lebel, a fact triumphantly announced in the Austrian press. The sights were updated to match the trajectory of the new cartridge, and these rifles were designated the Mannlicher 8890. In 1890, when the comparative battlefield power of the infantry rifle was at its absolute zenith, the armies of the dual monarchy could finally boast of having the most modern infantry rifle in the world. Now all they needed was a convenient war to prove that this was the most modern look what's going on in Chile! If you've never heard of the Chilean Civil War of 1891, check out the video on our sister channel, FTG Military History. The link will be in the description. Before the war, President Balmaceda of Chile ordered thousands of Mannlicher 88s from Steyr in 1889. They were completed and shipped right as the war began. The professional Prussian-trained Chilean army sided with El Presidente, and the Navy went with the Chilean Congress. In a huge stroke of luck, the ship delivering the Mannlicher rifles arrived just in time to be seized by the Congressional Navy. The Congressional Junta quickly raised an army and ordered millions of the semi-smokeless cartridges, which arrived in July. In the final great battles of the war, the hastily raised and quickly trained Congressional Army soundly defeated the professional government army in the battles of Concon and La Placilla in August of 1891. European observers struggled to find the words to describe the effect of incessant rapid fire from clip-loaded magazine rifles. At Concon, Congressional soldiers with Mannlicher rifles fired an average of 150 rounds apiece. The rifle was described as a hand machine gun that poured forth a veritable rain of fire. President Balmaceda's hapless infantry faced what a German observer described as a terrible storm of projectiles that left them unable to use their own weapons. In other words, they were effectively suppressed, a concept that remains the cornerstone of infantry tactics to this day. The Mannlicher rifle was unquestionably declared as the primary cause of the congressional victories. The European powers watched closely. The battles in Chile proved what they already suspected to be true. The old large-bore rifles were dangerously obsolete, and taking them to war against an enemy with modern small-bore rifles was to invite disaster. Within a few years, a more powerful, true smokeless powder was developed, but the Mannlicher 88's wedge-locking system was too weak. This led to the much better-known M95 Steyr Mannlicher, with stronger rotating locking lugs. Even so, not enough M95s were available in 1914, and the Mannlicher 88 remained in frontline use for the duration of the First World War. The 1888 Gewehrpatrone used 4 grams, or about 61 grains, of very high-quality compressed black powder. Modern Boxer Prime brass cases have less volume, and even with the help of my Corbin Swage press, I can't stuff more than about 53 grains into a case. This means my attempt to ballistically recreate the Gewehrpatrone 88 is doomed to fail. Although my bullet weight is almost exactly the same as the originals, those missing 8 grains or so of powder mean that velocity is far under the performance of this cartridge historically. I cast my bullets on an NOE 8mm bullet mold. It's a bore riding design, and I get excellent results with it. It is a black powder rifle, and it does make an enormous amount of smoke. It's also pretty darn dirty when it comes time to clean.
Where's the one trying to hide?
He's coming up.
A Russian is sneaking in around behind the Carpathians,
I think,
huh?
It's a serf.
There we go. Let's see, anyone on the hill?
Turks
on the hill. They're on our side.
Oh no! Well, then you can't aim at them.
No. Are you sure they're Turks? They're not Romanians?
Oh, they must be.
They
Romanians.
They must be Romanians. That ping just does not ever get old. I hit it, didn't I? Like nearly all surviving Mannlicher 88s, mine is actually an 8890 with the updated sights for the smokeless powder cartridge. I haven't worked up a smokeless powder load for this rifle that mimics the performance of the Gewehrpatrone 90,
Historically, the bullets were fully jacketed, which is necessary for higher velocities. So I mostly use smokeless powder to fire form cases into 8x52 Mannlicher from trimmed down 7.62x54 Russian. Once fire formed, I neck size and reload with black powder, which I think is just more fun to shoot. I'm Brett from PaperCartridges.com. I hope you enjoyed this video on what was, for about a day, the most modern infantry rifle
in the world.